Good morning, everybody. It's time for a new Drumdums Watches. I have my brand new vlog camera, the Canon G7X, and one of the main reasons I got this was because Drumdums Watches. I'm about to go to work. It's about 6:30 right now. Look at this view. Isn't this gorgeous? It looks like Camp Crystal Lake. That's my backyard, though, here in beautiful Melbourne, Florida. So I have it narrowed down because I posted last night on Killer Flicks, give me some choices for Drumdums Watches. So it's narrowed down to Strangers Pray at Night and the Texas Chainsaw Massacre remake. So I'm going to work right now. When I get back, hopefully I will have made my mind up. So Drumdums Watches, it's good to be back. Okay, here we go. I just got home from work. What's up, guys? Today, we are going to be doing Drumdums Watches. This is first time in a long time, and I've decided that the movie we're gonna do is, well, let me go get it. Let's go get it. Texas Chainsaw Massacre, the remake. And there's Levi. So we're going to put it in right now. We're not wasting any time, guys, because I'm on a time crunch here, okay? My wife gets home, this shit stops. But super excited to be doing this movie. I've reviewed the whole series and I posted on Killer Flicks. And you guys just gave me a shitload of choices. But one that really popped out at me was this one right here, Texas Chainsaw Massacre, the remake. So let's throw it in. And let me get around here because we got the sun in the way. I can prop this right here. Oh, and let's turn on the sound. Okay, we're getting started. Let me clap so I can compare the audio. But because I'm a little bit farther away, I'm gonna have this as an audio backup, my Zoom H1 external mic. But very similar opening to the original, because in the original you had that narration of the crimes from the past, and this is an account of what unfolded. So they're kind of doing the same thing. Yeah, so this is the aftermath. You got the detective and he's just looking after what went on, putting the pieces together. Now he says the Hewitt family. So I'm thinking there's the Hewitts and the Sawyers. I'm not like a diehard Texas Chainsaw Massacre guy. And I know that there's like families involved, but the most famous family is of course the Sawyers. So there you go. Texas Chainsaw Massacre, August 20th, 1973. Now I was actually born in July of 1973. So principal photography started shooting on this movie the same month that I was born. So I've always had kind of an affection for the Texas Chainsaw Massacre just because of that. But you know, tried and true formula here. You got a young couple, Texas heat, the very sexy Jessica Biel, and yeah, you know, I like that they didn't go too crazy with the family. They really made this movie serious. You know, it was just a very serious, almost like a documentarian account of just a heinous crime. That's kind of how they treated this. Directed by Marcus Nispel. So as we all know, they are on their way to a concert. You know, good little opening. I think they're going to like a Lynyrd Skynyrd concert, actually. Maybe that's why they're playing Sweet Home Alabama. But this movie doesn't waste any time. Like almost immediately, they run into the hitchhiker. And then the shit hits the fan. And I tell you guys, I'm using my vlog camera now, and this is just making this so much easier. Yeah, just makes the I can pick it up. I can put it stationary. I can walk around with it. You know, it's just really easy to manage. Okay, here is where the shit starts hitting the fan. This scene is pretty damn intense, actually. I mean, can you imagine a girl getting into your van and then she blows her head off like that? That will ruin a vacation. But quick shout out, Jessica Calloway Cambria. She was the one that, the first one that suggested the Texas Chainsaw Massacre remake. So I told her she's getting a huge shout out. But look at this, the way this film is shot. Isn't that beautiful? I mean, cinematography by Daniel Pearl in this movie, who did the first Texas Chainsaw Massacre. I mean, it just looks so beautiful. And both movies look very different, I guess. Maybe that's because they're you know, separated by 30 years. But now they have a situation on their hands. They got this person that just killed herself. They got a body they got to get rid of. They got to get to the authorities. This is not a good day. I mean, I can't imagine how much stress that would be. That would just be insane. That's one thing I love about horror too. Most of the times, horror involves situations that are just completely intense. And how do these characters deal with that intensity? And this is a perfect example of that. But check out Levi. This is one of the things he likes to do. He constantly ruins our couches because he wants to scratch and I have to tell him to stop it. Hey, Levi, stop it. But then how do you get mad at him? I mean, look how cute he is. And he likes the camera. Like, he doesn't shy away from the camera at all. So, I'm sorry, buddy. It was my fault. Scratch away. Now, this is kind of the resurgence of the remake craze. Really, this is kind of the start, because you could say The Thing, The Fly, those are remakes, but those kind of stood on their own. There was no, like, remake craze back then. Whereas for some reason, in the 90s, there was just this massive remake craze. And I think part of it is because we had all these great movies from the 70s and 80s. And, you know, you had this new generation. And studios, they saw a potential market. You know, it's a built-in audience. I mean, John Carpenter stated this at one of his conventions. You have an already established built-in audience. So remakes are really a no-brainer. When this movie was announced, everybody was like, oh, Texas Chainsaw Massacre. I know that franchise. I'd like to see a retelling of that story. And it just so happens, the movie was actually really good, at least by horror fans. It was well-received. You really can't blame them from a marketing standpoint. The problem is there's a lot of remakes that are not good. But the good news is the originals, they're still always there. But I haven't really seen a remake jumpstart a franchise. And what I mean by that is a remake is successful and then all of a sudden we get 3-4 more movies right after. And it's just like, you know, it's like a franchise 2.0. Now there are two more Texas Chainsaw movies after this one. But Texas Chainsaw 3D is a sequel to the very first Texas Chainsaw Massacre. So it's kind of strange, really, that studios today don't stick to their guns with a franchise. They're so quick to jump ship and start over. And the Halloween franchise is a great, great example of that. But now we're getting into crazy territory with the Sawyer family. And you can see how nice it is outside today. Very beautiful. And let's go take a look at the evil lair. That is a frying pan. And here is the evil lair, which we see every time I do a review. But I do get asked if I would like go through and talk about everything that's back here. But that is another video. Like, that would literally take me probably an hour to go through all this stuff. So just to give you guys like a quick rundown of it, there's the entire Halloween VHS collection. You got some Funkos here, Jack Torrance, Blade. There is the Strangers Prey at Night that I just bought. There's my Splatter University, which is one of my favorite VHSs. Ginger Snaps. There's some stuff up here at the top that you don't see in the frame, like Cavern of Terror. Zach sent me that. Psycho 2 and The Thing. A lot of these you guys have sent me, and I thank you for that. I have some of the best subscribers. My patrons, my subscribers, you guys are so good to me. Here's the Prowler. Gabriel Lewis sent me that, my last review. I just did that one. One of my favorite Funkos right there, the Carrie Funko. There is an official Drumdum, or not official, but there's a Drumdums Funko that my wife made. And then Woody Bowen, huge shout out to him. He painted that for me, which is beautiful, like the crow. Bones of Necro Zeus sent me that crow figure. And Emilio Gasca, there you go. This is an oldie but a goodie. He painted this for me, or drew this for me, this of the crow, a couple years ago, I think now. He drew that, and he drew that. And that's me in the Myers getup. So I've always loved that. And then there's my wife's paintings. There's the Myers painting. I kind of switch back and forth on the paintings, but yeah. And then there's my normal setup right there, the normal camera. So anyway, let's go back to the movie. Oh, Gabriel Lewis, more shout outs for him. Nightmare on Elm Street poster, Halloween, and Hell Night. Okay, so now the, let me turn it around here. So now here we are, you can see that, which way do I position this? Yeah, you can see that the these kids are, they're in a load of trouble right now. They gotta figure out what to do in this situation. So yeah, it's pretty rough. And R. Lee Ermey, rest in peace, will be here soon. Okay, we are well into the movie now, like the first act. And we just passed the scene where R. Lee Ermey makes an entrance. And one thing I love about this is how all the characters in this, they want to help everybody. And then, you know, you got the guy in the wheelchair. He seems like he's a good guy. But then everybody's got just something off about them, something really creepy. And R. Lee Ermey is a great example. And there he is right there. You know, you would hope that the sheriff, the authorities would be people that you could trust. So when you take that safety element out of the picture, then it gets really scary. And that's the situation these kids are in. Sheriff Hoyt is just a real piece of shit. He really is. And it makes you sad. You hope that the world is a good place and you hope that there aren't cops like this, but unfortunately, there probably are. Maybe not to this extent. Maybe to this extent, I don't know. I mean, I love the police department. I love what they do for us. They protect us. But I guess in every profession, you're gonna have people like that. Like the opposite end of the spectrum, I guess, if you will. And he represents that. You know, he's not a nice cop at all. He might be a good cop at what he does, but he's really corrupt. He's an asshole. Actually, I take that back. He's probably not a good cop. But look how gritty this movie is. I love that about it. How, you know, it's just so atmospheric and dark and brooding. To me, this one feels more cinematic than the original. The original feels more like a documentary, to tell you the truth. Like, you can't believe what's unfolding in front of you. Where this one, you feel like you're watching a movie. You know, it's still a good movie. It's one of the best remakes out there for a reason. Oh, that's Harry Knowles from Ain't It Cool News. That was his little cameo. They used his, I think that was his head. And look, I love these wide shots. There's the lovely Jessica Biel again. Probably one of the most attractive final girls in recent memory. And when you see, like, post your top 10 final girls, she usually makes the list as far as, like, looks go. So, and she's good in this, you know? She's the final girl that, like, stands up for, you know, she basically is in survival mode at the end of this movie. She doesn't lay down and just become a waif. So we're going to check now and see if we have any shout outs to do. Going to Facebook. I just posted probably like 10 minutes ago. Okay, we do have some. We got a few here. We got Tim Swope. He says, one of my favorite remakes. Shane Fontaine says, anytime you encounter somebody and the first things out of their mouth is along the lines of, they're all dead, he's a bad man, I'd say it's time to kick them out ASAP. That's a good point, Shane. George Hernandez, what's up, brother? He says, I personally enjoyed it. I watched it when it was released on VHS. Got to give it another view soon. Tyler Birdman says, I'm getting the original TCM Steelbook at Best Buy today. I actually got that Steelbook last week. Enjoy the movie. I've actually never seen this remake. What? Tyler, you've never seen Texas Chainsaw Massacre? The remake? It's one of the best remakes. Glenn Power says, watching Hallowstream for my birthday. Thank you, Glenn. That's awesome. Hallowstream was an amazing, amazing event. I can't believe I was able to get Dave McCray, Cody Leach, and we watched the movie all together and just talk about Halloween for 2 hours. And yeah, that's it was a cool event, and I've talked to them, and I think we're going to try to do Hollow Scream 2 and 3. We're going to do 2 because we didn't get a chance to talk about the franchise. We spent 2 hours just talking about the trailer, if you can believe it or not. And really just doing those Killer Flicks questions too, which was really fun. That was really fun, actually. So I'll probably do that for the next 2 Hollow Streams as well. I like getting interactive, like I'm doing with this. So here is our first big look at Leatherface, played by Andrew Bernarski. Look at that wide shot. Isn't that gorgeous? I wonder if that house is actually in Texas. I don't remember if they shot this movie in Texas or not. But I just love the wide shots in this movie. Like, look at that. There you go. There's a shot for you. That's kind of an homage to the original, the famous swing scene when the girl with the red shorts gets up and walks away from the swing set. This is very reminiscent of the original. But I like, you know, remakes that don't necessarily copy the original verbatim, and this one didn't. It kind of has its own flavor throughout, changes things up a bit, keeps it interesting. I think that's the big problem with like just using Rob Zombie's Halloween as an example. I don't think he went into that with the best plan, or even if he had the best plan, because the movie feels like 2 movies. Whereas this feels like 1 movie, and they're able to add their own touch here and there. That's the way to do it. Not do half a remake and then the other half, let's tell Michael Myers' backstory. Now they do try to tell Leatherface's backstory in the latest Leatherface movie. I didn't really like that. The more I think about it, the movie just didn't sit well for me at all. But Jessica Biel, Aaron, she's a good final girl because she's wanting to do the right thing. She's wanting to go back and save her boyfriend. You know, she doesn't want to leave him there, even though she knows that she could be going into certain danger. That makes me want to go to my refrigerator and get something to drink. See what we got in the fridge today. I have given up on the Monster for the most part. I still drink it from time to time, but it's horrible for you, so I try not to. And you see how the situation, it just gets worse and worse and worse. You know, it never lets up. It has different hills and valleys, but as far as like, if you look at like the overall pace of the movie, it's a gradual build. And now it's starting to get really messed up. Let's talk about Leatherface for a sec too. I think there's been so many like interpretations of Leatherface throughout the series, and I think that kind of determines how good the movie's gonna be. Because if you have a really shitty Leatherface, it'll pretty much ruin the movie, because that's what happened with Next Generation. I mean, that was only one of the problems of that movie, but here's Levi. Come here, buddy. There's Levi, guys. But yeah, this arguably is like one of the best Leatherfaces out of the whole franchise. Wouldn't you say so, Levi? Yeah, this is just a good old blood and guts horror movie. You know, doesn't complicate things. That's why I don't understand why they can't get the Friday the 13th. Well, I do understand it's the legal rights, but if you take away the legal rights, I never have understood why it was so hard to make a new Friday the 13th. And meanwhile, they keep churning out Texas Chainsaw Massacres. But yeah, from here on out, guys, it's pretty damn serious. I mean, it's been serious the whole time, but you start to get the feeling that these characters, they're not going to make it out of this. You know, that if more than one of them makes it out of it, then something's wrong. One good thing about the Texas Chainsaw Massacre in general is Leatherface isn't the only threat. Pretty much everybody's a threat in the Sawyer family. Yep, there he is again. Rest in peace. And nobody has had to use the bathroom yet. That's what's crazy. Arlie Ermey was amazing. I mean, it's amazing how he got the job on Full Metal Jacket with no acting experience whatsoever. Just had a history in the military. And yet, you know, look at him in this movie. He just shines. He really does. You know, he's kind of that psychological torture aspect of the movie. Like, he doesn't even have to lay a finger on him. He can
just destroy their mind, pretty much. You didn't have that in the original Texas Chainsaw Massacre either. You know, that's what Larry, that's what Arlie Ermey brought to the table. He said, "Hey, I'm going to give you another character that's just as scary as Leatherface, but in a completely different way."
Stepping outside right now. Let's calm down here for a bit, okay? Calm down and just take in this view. All right, look at that. Isn't that gorgeous?
It really looks like Camp Crystal Lake, doesn't it? And that's like another whole subdivision across the pond over there. I see some little duckies over there. But yeah. Just mowed the yard this weekend. The grass here grows pretty fast. So I'm having to mow it like at least once every other week. Which I guess isn't too bad, but yeah. And here is the Blu-ray collection. I have a Blu-ray, or just a collections playlist on my channel, but I'm definitely gonna have to do another one for steelbooks, because my steelbook collection's probably tripled since the last one I did, and that was like probably 3 years ago now. Now here's Trick or Treat. This is one that I got off of eBay. Cody Leach actually clued me in on this one, but because I don't think there's an official Blu-ray release in the States for Trick or Treat, so this is kind of a custom job. But as far as audio goes, I think it's the best version you can get out there. And Cody wanted me to do this Drumdums Watches with Trick or Treat, but I told him it'd probably be better to do it in September. So that's what I'm gonna do. And there's The Town That Dreaded Sundown. A lot of times I like to keep the movies that are in the queue, I guess, to review. I'll keep them out so that way I don't forget, because I do forget things sometimes. Now, I will say this remake, it's not my favorite remake. I don't think it's perfect by any means. I think there are some spots that drag, like this stuff right here. It's like they take the characters and they want to drop them from place to place to place to just try to beef up the story a little bit, keep you on edge throughout, but some of it does get monotonous. I will say this right now. I know some people prefer this one over the original. I don't agree with that at all. I think the original Texas Chainsaw Massacre is a much better movie than this one. Having said that, this is one of the better remakes of the last, like, I'll say like 20 years. But like the Evil Dead remake, I much prefer to this remake. That's one of my favorite remakes. But this one does have some really strong points, and that last act is really good. What is Levi doing? What are you doing, buddy? He's just kind of like contemplating life right now, just looking out the window. Poor little guy. Guys, here's what this camera looks like. I freaking love this thing. Yeah. But yeah, it's been nice. Okay, just to keep the flow going, I'm gonna do some more shout outs. You know, kind of just spread the shout outs throughout. Okay, I got, Dallas Jones, he says, "Great minds think alike, just threw my Blu-ray on too." Nice. Cody Archer says, "Best outfit in horror history. My wife wore the same thing in college on Halloween. Good memories. Love the remake just as much as the original. Take care, Lee." That's funny. I just talked about, I prefer the original, but yeah, like I said, this is still a good remake. And then Brandy Moore says, "I love this movie." Awesome. And you know what? We'll go ahead and do some Instagram love here too. All right. Instagram, we got MPinky182, great remake. Brett Renard says, "Best horror remake in my humble opinion." Gian Carlord, I hope I said that right, "Childhood favorite, I love this film." JD Neal 79 says, "Pretty decent remake. Wasn't a fan of the first film. I saw it. Some dude puked in the row in front of me right before the movie started. Sort of ruined the experience." That would ruin the experience. And then, "But it grew on me when I saw it on DVD." Gilverio says, "That's funny, I'm watching the Texas Chainsaw Massacre right now. I don't like the remake's Leatherface. I prefer the original." Interesting, there you go. And there is a wet Jessica Biel. She really pours it out emotionally in this last act. And I just saw a TV show with her recently that was really good, actually. I'll have to look it up. I'm trying to remember the name of it. So yeah, that's a tough scene because she had to kill her boyfriend to put him out of his misery. And there's what that's the thumbnail I used for my review for this movie, actually. I always like to have blood on my thumbnails. I don't know. The Sinner, that's it, The Sinner. I just watched that recently. That was a good show, actually. Nice little twist ending. Jessica Biel and her sister, they have kind of a rough relationship, but you can tell it's one of those that it peels the layers back as the story goes, and you're trying to find out why this tragedy happened. But I definitely recommend it, The Sinner. Really good. But Jessica Biel just up and kills this guy at the beginning of the show. That's not a spoiler. That's like in the very first episode. And so the rest of it is trying to figure out why she just had this, you know, conniption and she just killed the guy. And so that's what the show's about. Really good, though. Bill Pullman is in it. Nice to see him. I don't see Bill Pullman that much anymore, actually. But yeah, he was good. Some crazy stuff going on right now. We are in the last act, people. Jessica Biel is running for her life. The other guy, I believe he just got sawed up by Leatherface, and she's getting the hell out of there. Look at that lighting, Daniel Pearl. That's just beautiful. I mean, it's not realistic, but it's beautiful. Like you're not gonna see that kind of lighting when you're outside, you know, at like 2 o'clock in the morning. But yeah, here's another great example. Like every place Jessica Biel another great example though, like every place Jessica Biel goes, you don't trust it. Like, I don't trust this guy in this station wagon. I don't know what town that these people are stuck in, but it's like Helltown. And this is probably my favorite scene aesthetically of the movie. I just love this like factory setting at the end. Factories in horror movies is always a good thing. Always a good thing. Yeah, but she is running for her life. And another good thing about the Texas Chainsaw franchise is you never know how it's going to end. Sometimes nobody survives. So that's a good thing in a horror movie. You know, those franchises where the final girl lives, there's at the end of every one, it kind of takes something out of it, you know? But we don't know if she's going to live in this or not. I'm a cinematography nut, and that just looks gorgeous. It really does. That's one thing I love about this remake. And the prequel is actually really good too. Like sometimes I think I might prefer the Texas Chainsaw A New Beginning to this one. But this last act I think is better than A New Beginning. It's a great last act. But New Beginning, I think I like everything up to the last act better than this movie. She's having to hide inside meat. Can you imagine having to, well, I guess it wouldn't stink because it's freezing. Somebody just posted on Killer Flicks the other day about Black Christmas, and wouldn't the body be, wouldn't the body stink? And because the attic wasn't heated, it wouldn't stink. It's probably like 20 degrees in there. Yeah, that's every time you hear that chainsaw, it's a great thing, you know? The chainsaw sound is like horror candy, carnage candy. It's amazing to me how little blood is in the original, actually. You know, you don't really do that much these days, especially in like these slasher icon type movies. You gotta have buckets of blood. Bring buckets of blood to the set. It's like a staple now. I'm sure the new Halloween's gonna have tons of blood. That is an awesome shot right there. I think she's just gonna make a run for it, right? I haven't seen this in a while. I haven't seen this since the last time I reviewed it, and that was a while ago.
Hey guys, real quick, one more set of shout-outs here. Christina Healy from Killer Flicks. I love this movie maybe more than the original, as I saw the first one, and I own the two-disc on DVD. Shane Saborski says, the TCM remake is one of the best remakes. I remember seeing it on the theater before seeing the original and thought it was awesome. Jacob Damian says, just think about what Rob Zombie could do with that franchise. Michael Jones says, I absolutely adore this film. Scared the hell out of me when I first saw it. So damn good. George Hernandez says, I personally enjoyed it. I watched it when it was released on VHS. Got to give it another viewing soon. Dan Wolf, my good buddy Dan Wolf, says, I want to shout out because I liked Texas Chainsaw Massacre 3D. Me too. I don't get the hate. Parker Smichael, Iron Maiden fan, says, I really enjoyed this remake. Are you still going to give a shout out, Lee? Yes, I am. There you go. Horror rules. Brian Kinzer says, that's a good one. Jordan Knight says, just watched this on the other day. Easily one of the best remakes. Jack Palace, one of the very few remakes that can actually revival of the great original. The original is more subtle, the remake more explicit, but both are very effective when it comes to disturbing their audience. Jason Smith says, so great, from Sinister Cinema Reviews. Suzette O'Reilly says, great remake. And Jacob Damian says, wait, I got it. James Wan for a remake of Tourist Trap. I'd do that. And John White says, that scene besides Jessica has the main protagonist lady from Hostel 2. Okay, cool. And real quick, over to Instagram, I got some more shout outs from Screaming Tatum. Drumdum's one of the best remakes out there. Megan Friels Johnson, director of The Ice Cream Truck and good friend, one of my faves. Andretto T Mark, I know I said that wrong. Only need three more to complete my TCM collection. Anthony P 3301 says, I love this remake, one of the best out there. A fairly different fun than the original classic, but great in its own right. Ryan Day 92 says, great remake, one of the best in my opinion. Drumdums. Cody said, from Cody Leach says, to date the scariest theater experience I've ever had. Will always love this movie for that. And Arlie Ermey, rest in peace. You got that right, Cody. Robbie Sobel says, probably my favorite remake post 2000. And I think I might have already said this one, but I'll say it. Gil Vario, that's funny. I'm watching the Texas Chainsaw. I like the remake's Leatherface. I prefer the original. I prefer the original too, actually. So, back to the exciting finale of the Texas Chainsaw Massacre remake, Drumdums Watches.
So anyway, guys, this is about it. I'm gonna put the camera on there. One last look at the Texas Chainsaw Massacre remake from 2003. This was a lot of fun. And I can't believe this movie came out so long ago. What is that, 15 years now? If I do the math right, I think, say 2003, you carry the 10, that gets us to 2013. And then 2018 minus 2013 is 5, so that gives us 15. So yes, I think I'm right on that. That's a little Howard Stern humor there for you too, by the way. What is she doing now? So I guess it's not over yet. I was thinking it was over. She's in the truck, but I guess it's not over. Oh, that's it. Yeah, she gets that last dig in. Hits Sheriff Hoyt with the car. So that way we get that nice, happy ending. And then did she run over him again? Yes, she does. Oh, he's done. He is done. And she loses her mind. I love a good ending where the final girl just completely goes apeshit. That was one of the good things about Rob Zombie's Halloween. I liked that she went completely apeshit at the end and shot Myers in the face. But that's it, guys. That wraps up another Drumdums Watches. Feels good to be back. Haven't done one of these in so long. So post in the comments your thoughts on the Texas Chainsaw Massacre remake. Had a lot of fun doing this, and looking forward to the next one. So anyway, guys, make sure you come over to Killer Flicks, where we talk horror all day and every day, and on Fridays we do Free for Fridays. Follow me at Drumdums on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Letterboxd, and now Stardust. If you like what I'm doing, hit that subscribe button. I'd really appreciate it. Anyway, guys, oh shit. Thanks for watching, and Drumdum out.